okay, let's say I want to prevent everybody from accessing Bash. I can tell the administrator or the security person, hey, somebody is trying to use Bash. Bash sucks, right? You can send a notification. Now, that is what BPF does. So you have a lot of events that you can hook onto. There are lots of hooks that you can hook onto from your kernel space and do stuff like it. So I'm going to walk you through what eBPF is, but before that, I'll just get you through a few other fundamentals and the evolution of eBPF in general. So it's going to be a very high-level talk. I'm not getting into a lot of implementation. I don't think I'll have a lot of time to do a demo either. So I'll probably give you some idea of what we're doing. I'm Vishnu. Most of you guys know me. Some of you I've met in previous meetups. So I'm an engineering manager with the platform team. So the platform team deals with everything that everybody doesn't want to deal with. So that is your CI/CD and your Kubernetes clusters, and making sure everything is up all the time. So that is what we do. So I lead that team, and most of the team is here. So after the talk, you should probably go and talk to them. Cool, let's get started. How many of you guys know TCP DAW or have used it before? Where does this program understand what to do? So you have the command TCP DAW, and you have some text, which basically says TCP and destination port is 9200. Right? Okay, let's get into that. So the part there after the TCP dump is basically a text string. It's basically like code, right? It's an expression. Now, what TCP dump does is a few things. It passes that expression. It compiles into something called a BPF bytecode. So BPF bytecode basically, I'll show you what that is. So it compiles that, it passes that expression, compiles it into BPF bytecode. Then in the kernel space, it goes and talks to the network socket, it opens a socket, and basically runs a BPF program. So that BPF bytecode is a program. Now that program is run against the TCP socket. Now, so the network socket. Now what that does is that you can pretty much do, so the TCP dump program, which is the expression now, is now being evaluated against the packets that are being received on that socket. And then it's basically pretty printed, right? Now, if you want to see what the TCP dump expression is evaluated to, there's a simple hyphen D command that you can run. And this is what it looks like. Does anybody know what this is? This is assembly, yes. Or what LDH is, of course, a load. And J equal to is basically an equality. So what it is doing is, it is looking at assuming that it is an Ethernet connection. It is looking at the 12th frame, a half byte there, or two bytes, I guess, two words. And it's basically checking whether it is the start of the packet. So that 0x800 is what basically designates an Ethernet frame, the start of an Ethernet frame. So if it is at the start of an Ethernet frame, it is jumping to 2. If it is false, it is jumping to 9 and then doing something else. Now, the second command, it's loading 23. It's looking at a particular part in the packets, and it is looking for 0x6, which is essentially TCP. It is a number for TCP. So if it was UDP, it would probably be 0x11, right? So now, what TCP dump does is TCP dump compiles this into bytecode, injects it into the kernel, it runs in the kernel, and basically looks at the packets. So it basically does the things that we talked about in the previous slide, right? It opens a connection, and every packet that is coming through is being evaluated against this BPF program and is being reported back into your TCP program. This is what a classical BPF program does. So there's a very nice paper about how this is done. I'll make sure that is linked in the YouTube description. Right, so this is what a BPF program is. You're basically executing some arbitrary bytecode in your kernel. So there is essentially a C program that we can write, which basically compiles this expression using this expression, the TCP and DST port 9200 to basically the bytecode. So it is essentially what it is doing, because we deal with static analysis. So what it is essentially doing is basically passing that expression and basically compiling it to bytecode. So I don't know if you guys have worked with libpcap, so there's a library that you can use, which basically gives you all this functionality right out of the box. So writing a C program for compiling this into bytecode is pretty easy. Now let's get into some fundamentals. Now the fundamental thing, operating systems 101, everybody knows this diagram pretty much, I'm assuming. So you have your user space, where your user space program runs, your user land. Now you have your kernel space, where your kernel programs run. You have your file descriptors, sockets, TCP, IP, all of that stuff, right? Your transaction transmission control, everything runs there. So the kernel space exists so that you can expose a very standard interface to your application program, right? You can make, if you want to open a file, you can basically send a standard API contract to your kernel and basically execute programs. Now, of course, there is a hardware underneath all of this. Now, the kernel space, how does it understand, okay, I have to write to an NVMe disk or to a SSD disk? Any ideas? What do you use for that? So how does the kernel space, how does your operating system understand, okay, I have a Hitachi card disk versus I have a Toshiba card disk. What does it use? Drivers, yeah. So you have drivers, and so your kernel space understands those drivers. It will interface with the drivers to basically do all those operations. So this is what your operating systems 101 tells you about. So your process interacts with your kernel space interacts with your hardware using drivers. Okay. What if you wanted more things to be done with the kernel? What if you wanted to write a program that reports every time there is a packet signature that matches twitter.com or contains some packet sequence that you know is sending your responses for, it's basically mining Bitcoin. If you can identify those packet sequences, you wanted to do something. How would you extend your kernel to do it? How would you do that? At a kernel level, how do you do this? Kernel modules, yes. That's one of the options. There are two options. One is you raise a pull request to your kernel source code, wait 10 years, you'll get a new kernel version, you're done. Or you use a kernel module. Now, there is a problem with kernel modules. So kernel modules would break as soon as a new version of kernel comes out. Your kernel can change its APIs, its functions, and your kernel module will break. You'll have to rewrite it and release a new version of your kernel module for that specific kernel version. How do you solve this? This is where eBPF comes into play, right? Or BPF in general. So after this point, and when I say BPF, it's eBPF, right? So BPF is the extended Berkeley packet filter. What it does is it gives you a lot more control in terms of what you can do with BPF programs. So you can load programs into your kernel space and do stuff. Okay, how do you do stuff? Now, so there are lots of hooks. There are hooks in the kernel space so that BPF understands. Like for example, you have this execve hook. Now this can be used so that execve syscall, once the kernel receives it, if you have a BPF program running in the kernel space, can understand, hey, somebody is trying to execute something. So when you do, okay, let's say I want to prevent everybody from accessing bash. I can just write a BPF program that detects, hey, somebody, this is being opened, and I can just close it, right? Or I can tell the administrator or the security person, hey, somebody is trying to use bash. Bash sucks, right? You can send a notification. Now, that is what BPF does. So you have a lot of events that you can hook onto. There are lots of hooks that you can hook onto from your kernel space and do stuff with it. It's not just kernel space. It can hook onto things in the user space as well. So you can pretty much instrument all of your kernel and user space with hooks, right? You have hooks like your JavaScript callbacks or whatever, right? So you can execute some arbitrary source code. In like when the application loads up, you can inject it into the kernel without waiting for anybody to compile it or bake it into your operating system. You can write an application which basically injects your kernel space with some arbitrary source code, and that does stuff, right? Now, so this is basically a diagram it's available on the internet. It's a pretty famous diagram. So your eBPF supports all of these things. You have K probes, you have U probes. So probes were something that were used for this specific functionality where you wanted to execute a function call when something happened. So you have probes, you have K probes, you have all your syscalls, everything as trace points. So you can attach to one of these trace points, like your execve, right? Your execve, I can attach it to your execve trace point, or there is an execve return trace point. That is when the execve returns, I can hook onto that and do stuff like your browser. Now like your JavaScript, right? You can basically control what your kernel is doing. You can see what your kernel is doing, right? So all of these things are supported. So syscalls, your network calls, all of that can be controlled from, or you can basically get observability into your kernel space. So you basically have, you can see what is going on within your system. This comes in very handy in the modern world of Kubernetes, right? Cool. So let's talk about the runtime. So how do you build an eBPF program? Now, eBPF programs can be written in a lot of different languages. You can even write it in Python. Now, you can have a Python object or a C program and compile it using Clang into a BPF target. So you basically get your eBPF bytecode generated from any program that you can write. So you can write it in C, you can write it in Python, whatever it comes. So it basically supports cross-compiles into LLVM, and from LLVM you get access to this. Now, this can be now injected into your kernel space using another syscall. So there's a BPF syscall, which can be used to basically push it into your kernel. Now, the kernel does not just let you run whatever you want, because I don't want blue screen of deaths and stuff. So what I do is, I have there is something called a verifier. Now, what the verifier does is that verifier checks, hey, is this program going to crash? Is this program going to get into an infinite loop? Is it accessing memory variables like that I'm not supposed to? Memory areas that I'm not supposed to access? Is that something this program doing? That is what the verifier does. So once the verifier says, hey, this is good, so it does some static analysis and kind of figures out, hey, this is good to go. After that, there's a JIT. There's a JIT compiler that compiles it into machine-specific code. So your initial, the BPF program is in a machine-independent bytecode. Now that is converted into instruction sets for that particular architecture, if it is x86 or, you know, AMD64, ARM64, whatever. So based on the machine's platform, you can compile it into bytecode, and now that is loaded into your kernel. Now suppose there is a process that is being instrumented. Now the process can listen. So whenever the process issues some syscall, some event happens, or some event that we talked about in the previous slide happens, that particular program, that BPF program, can actually talk to your user space process. So that means every time, for example, if I'm using XAVE as an example, every time somebody opens a file, I can get a notification. I can send you an email or a Slack notification when somebody opens a file, right? So it's pretty simple to do that. Now, and this basically gives me control over the entire operating system, or observability into pretty much a lot of things. So there is something called maps, which I think I might have missed. So there are maps. So what if you wanted to store state, right? Your BPF program wanted to store state, like you wanted to store a variable. Say you're counting how many packets are being sent on this particular port. If you wanted to do that, and your application is only processing it every 5 seconds, where do you store that counter? Now the counter can be stored in an eBPF map. So these maps, you can have different maps. You can have a ring buffer, you can have a hash map, all of that. You can store it in a small memory dedicatedly for this eBPF program to access. So that is basically your state storage. Just think of it as some memory, some part of memory which can be used by these BPF programs to store state and talk to your user space systems or do some logic there. Now, there are also helper functions. So what if you wanted to get a random number? So there are some kernel space helpers that are pretty stable over time, that doesn't change as much as other functions within the kernel. That is available, so it's not a good idea to make function calls directly to your kernel functions, because your kernel function changes all the time, right? So whenever a new version of kernel is updated, there might be breaking changes which might not work. So you have these helper functions which are pretty stable for a long time, long periods of time within a kernel's life cycle. So you have access to those helper functions as well. Now comes the main topic of the discussion. All right, so with Kubernetes, what can I do to solve this? What can I use eBPF for? Right, so with Kubernetes, how you do that is your kernel space is shared between all these processes, right? Your kernel space is shared by all these containers. Now, what that lets you do is that your Kubernetes, your pods are running somewhere, it's executing processes, load balancing, all of that stuff. Now, in here, your kernel is now shared. Now, with a shared kernel, how do I do this? So I can have the BPF program loaded into the node's kernel space. That is a shared kernel space. And this BPF program can execute something It can basically look at whatever you want to look at. It can basically instrument all of this data. Now, your pod one is executing some app, you know, it's say we found out is doing Bitcoin mining. Now, that signature can be intercepted at the kernel level, and you can look at, so one problem there is that, say, okay, let's say a TCP dump, for example. You're basically dumping your TCP packets. You're basically monitoring your TCP packets that is flowing through. Okay, I'm giving TCP as an example. It could be a whole host of other things. Now you have your kernel space there. So your node is where you have 10 containers running. The node is monitoring that. So there is a PID associated with it. But say, let's say you're using network, then your source and destination IP address is what I have, or addresses is what I have, right? Now, what that lets me do is, so the problem is with, say, containers are going up and down, there is a lot of IP addresses that are being used, it keeps changing, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So how do I solve that? So now you can build a BPF program, and the user space program that is controlling this BPF program or reacting to the events from the kernel can actually talk to your Kube API to make sure you annotate with metadata, right? You can understand, hey, this process uses this particular PID within the container, or this is, and you can use Kube API to correlate all this metadata, and you can basically annotate the data that you're receiving from the host machine and do stuff with it, right? You can now prevent a particular image with a vulnerability. I can say, hey, as soon as I detect this pattern of events, like, let's say a particular threat object, like let's say a simple malware that exists in a pod or is baked into an image without us knowing, is being deployed by us. Say your MySQL image is compromised, there is a package, and we know that, but if we know that, if there is a pattern there, which I can look at, it's opening these files, it's doing these things, there is a packet, there is a sequence of events, I can monitor it, right? So now that can be baked into your node and these rules, and it can make correlate everything from the Kubernetes API and kind of make sense as to what it is doing, right? Your Kube API will basically give you all the metadata, and you can apply rule sets against it, right? I'll just wanted to kind of touch upon two of the things that we use here. We use Falco and we use Cilium. So Cilium is used for network load balancing. We use it for L7 access control. So we want to block egress from our containers to certain domains, et cetera. So we use Cilium for a lot of those things. We use Falco for runtime threat detection. So what Falco lets you do, and I kind of wanted to draw parallels between, okay, so these two projects use eBPF underneath, and I wanted to tell you what it does. So you have an application, this is Falco's or Sysdig, I mean, they pretty much have a similar architecture in terms of how they interact with your eBPF programs. So you have your user space and you have your kernel space. You have an instrumented application, which is whatever you wanted to target, and there is a eBPF hook that is triggered, and then the Falco or Sysdig is looking at those signatures or particular event chains, which it makes sense of and kind of identifies. It's basically recognize a pattern of events, and then it can now alert us saying, hey, there is a runtime vulnerability that is being detected. And we can go and look at where it is originating from, and we can make sure we can resolve it, right? Like, so it could most likely be from some package that is being introduced or compromised. With a new vulnerability gets announced, we'll probably know that, hey, there is this. So Falco, you can make rule sets and you store it, and that is underneath all of that, the BPF program is what is actually doing a lot. So Falco does a lot of other things too, but Sysdig actually does a lot of other things too, but at the at one side of it, this is how it detects container vulnerabilities in real time. Now, Cilium is a network, it's a CNI provider. I don't know if you guys know about, it's a container networking interface provider. So we use this for access control for some of these things. So again, it's the same thing. So you have your network policy, services, all of this stuff that is defined with Cilium. So Cilium again uses eBPF to control the flow of packets from the network, and that's how it gives you L3 to L7 load balancing, for example, right? So you can even detect, we can set up, again, a lot of network policies, et cetera, that you would otherwise find it hard to do. So these two projects, this is how you use it. Now, pretty much anybody here can, if you know a little bit of C, and if you can spend some time, and if you, I mean, I write it in Go, but you can actually write a pretty simple eBPF program in Go, and of course, a BPF program will be written in C because it's easier to write because you have all the signatures, et cetera. But essentially what you can do is you can go and explore. There's plenty of documentation available on how to do it. There are talks there who explain how to do it. You can actually look at that and kind of start playing around with this and build your own BPF programs. I wanted to do a demo, but then since I'm running a little over time, I'll probably not do the demo right now. But yeah, so that is basically my talk. And we are hiring. Just a plug, we are hiring. So the platform team is definitely hiring. We are the ones who work with all this stuff. We are the ones who write the Kubernetes. We maintain the Kubernetes clusters. We have multiple clusters. We maintain those clusters. We use Falco. We run the security team, which takes care of Falco and other runtime vulnerability detection, all of that. So if you guys are interested, drop in your resumes or visit the DeepSource jobs. Cool. Thanks a lot, guys. Bye-bye.